They are a Florida icon. Smart, agile, and playful. Dolphins have sparked the imaginations of many, and their undersea world might be linked with ours more than we know.
We look at the bottlenose dolphins as very good sentinels of the health of the coastal ecosystem.
Dolphins are a barometer. They're an apex predator in an environment that we all share.
They're breathing the same air that we breathe. They're swimming through the same water in which we swim. They're eating the same fish that we catch. And granted, we're not in the water as much as they are, and we're not eating as many of the fish, but if problems were going to show up, we would expect them to show up in the dolphins first.
For decades, toxic chemicals have made their way into the oceans, leaving fish and marine mammals vulnerable.
Dolphins that have washed up in various places, including the southeast United States, they have to be treated as toxic waste. The levels of contaminants are so high.
Some animals show disturbing signs of immune system dysfunction and disease, which may be linked to contaminant exposure.
They're kind of like the 400-pound miner's canary. These animals are telling us what's happening. We've used the oceans as our toilet for centuries, and now I think we're starting to see the effects of that through all these new health issues that are coming up.
So if these dolphins here on our coastlines, these apex predators, they're getting sick, well, who's next? And it's the humans.
Major funding for this program was provided by the Bachelor Foundation, encouraging people to preserve and protect America's underwater resources.
Bottlenose dolphins are common in Florida waters. They are social animals which eat about 20 pounds of fish a day and can live to be over 50. Dolphins have few natural predators other than man. As the population along Florida's coastline increases, so do the threats to the curious marine mammals.
Increased boating traffic leads to boat hits. Dolphins are increasingly entangled in fishing line or ingesting the fishing gear that leads to their slow and painful death.
And not all threats to the animals are as obvious. Contaminants which are lurking beneath the surface are also impacting the marine mammals' long-term health. In the coastal waters off Miami, scientists with NOAA's National Marine Fisheries Service have been studying bottlenose dolphins for more than 15 years.
Did you see him again yet? Oh, there he is, Joe.
A photo ID study helps the researchers gather information about the resident dolphins.
The dolphins get natural markings and nicks and scar patterns on their dorsal fin. We take photographs of those. Then back at the lab, we can match animals up to the photo ID catalog, and that's what allows us to follow the population over time to understand their movement patterns.
I think we got them pretty good, huh?
Through observation, the scientists discovered that the animals live in distinct areas.
Certain animals tended to be sighted primarily in the northern half of the bay by the city of Miami and the port of Miami, where other dolphins tended to be more in the south towards Card Sound.
The northern half of the bay is close to urban development, while the southern half is mainly surrounded by agriculture. To find out if the northern group of animals has higher levels of contaminants than the southern dolphins, the experts collected small blubber samples.
All right, the next one he comes up, I'm gonna take a shot.
We fire a small dart with a stainless steel sampling head. that hits the dolphin and has a float to keep it from going too deep and allows the dart to bounce off. The dart then floats and we're able to pick it up and retrieve the sample. And it's only about a centimeter in diameter. It's a very small sample.
The biopsy samples were analyzed for a group of contaminants called persistent organic pollutants, or POPs, which have been found in marine mammals around the world.
We looked at over 80 compounds, PCB congeners, DDTs, which are pesticides, and also the PBDEs, which are flame retardants. The PCBs historically were used in industry in things like transformers and have been banned from production but are still found in some older transformers and equipment today.
DDT is a pesticide made infamous in the 1960s when its harmful effects on human health and the environment became known. The use of it and PCBs was banned in the United States in the 1970s. But these compounds degrade very slowly. Transported by wind and ocean currents, high levels of these toxins can still be found in the environment today, in as faraway places as the Arctic.
These chemicals are very, very persistent in the environment, and we're still finding them in organisms all over the world.
Another potentially harmful group of contaminants called PBDEs are still legally produced in most U.S. states.
The flame retardants are currently produced today, and we're concerned about those because they're very similar in structure to PCBs. They persist in the environment, they can be toxic, they are known to transport around the world in a similar way that PCBs did. And they're found in our homes on a regular basis now. They're in our electronics, in our furniture, in our carpet, in our cars, used as flame retardants widely.
Exposure to these chemicals has been linked to a number of health problems.
All of those chemicals have been identified as most likely endocrine disruptors. They can impact the immune system, they can decrease reproductive success, they can cause problems with the hormones such as estrogen levels and thyroid hormones. They can also impact neurological development, so they are definitely compounds of concern for both dolphins as well as humans.
Marine mammals are especially vulnerable to these pollutants because they bioaccumulate in the animal's blubber.
The organic pollutants bind to fat cells, and so they'll be bound to particles in the sediment, and then the small organisms that feed off the sediments will accumulate the contaminants from the sediment. The larger fish eat the smaller fish, and it continues to accumulate up the food chain because those contaminants are binding in the fat stores. So the animals that are on the top of the food chain are getting much larger doses that have been accumulated through the food chain over time, and that's true for both dolphins and humans.
There we go.
In Miami's Biscayne Bay, scientists discovered that the northern group of dolphins did have higher levels of most contaminants than the southern group.
We found that the northern group had extremely high levels of PCBs, and in fact, the males in the northern half of the bay had five times higher PCBs than those in the southern half of the bay.
As a matter of fact, the dolphins in northern Biscayne Bay have the highest levels of PCBs of all the dolphins studied in Florida.
I would expect higher levels of contaminants here because of a higher urban area, more industrial inputs. Even going back in the 60s and 70s, Miami was much more populated than some of these other areas of Florida.
Since dolphins and humans eat some of the same fish, several people have questioned the levels of contaminants in humans. To get some answers, the Centers for Disease Control is now conducting a pilot study of local fishermen in Biscayne Bay to test if they too have high levels of persistent organic pollutants in their bodies. POPs have been linked to a slew of health problems in people. And according to the Environmental Protection Agency, humans are mainly exposed to POPs through contaminated foods.
I certainly am a lot more careful about how much seafood I eat of various kinds. The fish offer a lot in terms of health benefits, but they also offer a lot of threats when you start looking at the contaminants that are found in them.
All right, Jace, you got the bat line?
Got it. Ready?
Okay.
Dr. Randall Wells heads the world's longest-running dolphin research program in Sarasota Bay on Florida's west coast.
The Sarasota Dolphin Research Program, under the auspices of the Dolphin Research and Conservation Institute of the Chicago Zoological Society, has been based here at Moat Marine Laboratory actually since its start back in 1970.
There it is.
We have a span of five generations that we're currently observing out in Sarasota Bay as long-term residents as part of a community.
Each year, researchers conduct a health assessment of the area's dolphins.
The health assessment involves finding a selected group of dolphins in shallow water and setting a net around that group of dolphins and working with each individual one at a time on a specially designed veterinary examination boat. We take a suite of measurements, a suite of samples, we mark the animal if it's not already recognizable to us, and then release it right there on site.
One of the challenges scientists face is determining what levels of toxins are harmful to the dolphins' health, since they can't do experiments on the animals. Studies have been conducted on other species, however, and conclusions were drawn about the threshold levels in dolphins.
The threshold level is one that was established theoretically looking at other mammals, and what we find is that our males mostly are in excess of that threshold level where you would begin to expect to see health problems or reproductive problems. And we suspect this may be one of the reasons why we see hints of immune system dysfunction in the older males, why we see the older males not living as long as females.
Dr. Wells says females are thought to have a longer lifespan because they offload contaminants to their firstborn calves.
As they're putting on blubber in preparation for the winter, they're eating a lot of fat-rich fish. These fish have higher levels of the contaminants than the fish earlier in the year. It goes into the blubber of the dolphins. It stays there until the spring when the animals start to shed some of the lipids that were in their blubber. So as these contaminants are released from the blubber, they either can go to target organs and be a problem, they can be biotransformed into more lethal forms or into less lethal forms, they can be excreted in some cases, or they can be passed on in the milk to the young dolphins. And that's where one of the more serious problems occurs, we believe. We've been able to measure the levels of contaminants in females that have yet to lactate, and they are much higher than they are in older females that have given birth and have lactated. In looking at firstborn calves in Sarasota Bay, we find that they have higher levels of contaminants than do the secondborn, thirdborn, fourthborn, fifthborn, and most of the firstborn calves don't survive.
Coming up, straight ahead.
Bottlenose dolphins in the coastal waters of Florida are sentinels of ecosystem health, so we should be concerned. We shouldn't be frightened, but we should be concerned, and we should be looking as best we can at those aspects of the environment that impact us as well.